Ladies and gentlemen, and my dear students, I worked in many a post, but after coming to the institution of Lokayukta, I very often feel that till then I was a frog in the well. I really did not know the sufferings of the people in the ground level. I was comfortable, and I thought everybody else was also comfortable. My message to the youth of today is, if you want to change the society, which I feel you should do that, you should inculcate two values. Our elders have created many values, but I am placing before you two values for the time being. One is contentment in life. If you don't have contentment in life, you get a disease called greed. It has no treatment. There is no limitation. Any amount you make, you're not satisfied. That is the disease of greed. Just to give you a background of this growth of disease again in the society, in the decade of 50s, there was a scam called the Jeep scam. Country lost 52 lakhs of rupees in importing Jeep vehicles from UK to the soldiers of India. Thereafter, there were many scams were there, the Mundra scam of LIC, Dalmia scam of Bharat Bank, Nagarwala scam of Central Bank. Every time the scam came to the public domain, the number of zeros in the figure started growing. In the 80s, there was a major scam, Bofors. I'm sure many of you would have heard about it. Country lost 64 crores of rupees. 2010, there were two scams, Commonwealth Games. Country lost 70,000 crores of rupees. This is not my figure. This is the figure given to the Government of India after an inquiry by an officer called Comptroller and Auditor General of India. He reported in Commonwealth Games, country lost 70,000 crores. Same year, 2G scam. Country lost 1,76,000 crores. 2012, Colgate. Country lost 1,86,000 crores of rupees. Compare this figure with the budget of state of Karnataka for 2016-2017, earmarked for one full year for 6.5 crores of people, for 4 lakh government servants' salary, is only 1,65,000 crores. As against one scam where 1,86,000, 1,76,000, 70,000 crores were siphoned off. 2017-2018, for the current year, the state government has marked 1,80,000 crores for 6.5 crores of people. And few people have siphoned off 1,86,000, 1,76,000, 70,000 crores. How can there be development? In 2009, I saw a photograph of a lady in a deserted place, sitting in the ground, scraping the topsoil with her bare fingers. The article below the photograph said she has walked 5 to 6 kilometers from her house in search of water. If she gets one pot of water, she is very happy, irrespective of the quality of the water, because there is something to, for the members of the family to drink and to cook. Forget washing, bathing and everything. Same year, CAG reported to the Government of India that out of lakhs and lakhs of crores given to various state governments for providing drinking water only, 56,000 crores were unaccounted for. We talk of development. We say Karnataka is a developed state. Yes, comparatively to others. But what is development with so much of money being siphoned off? What's the consequences of that? Because we live in a society which today respects the corrupt. 46 in anticipation of getting independence to this country. Our elders created a body called the Constituent Assembly. The object of the assembly was to create and draft a constitution for this country. And many elders who fought for the freedom of the country, people who excelled in their own profession, were members of the Constituent Assembly. And look at the debate that went on there. The first issue that came for consideration was what type of a political system that this country should adopt when it became independent. Many elders spoke and said, we Indians were never ever independent. We were under the rules of Rajas, Maharajas, Zamindas. They pleaded with emotion. They said, now that we are going to become independent, let's adopt a political system by which every Indian feels this governance is mine, this country is mine. Meaning of the word democracy then in 1946 was government of the people, by the people, for the people. And our elders adopted that as the political system. Let me give you another incident which took place there. The Constituent Assembly functioned from 1946 to 1949, November, and produced a wonderful document about the Constitution of India. In that second incident, the issue was for discussion was whether a person who wanted to contest election should have an educational qualification or not. Many elders pleaded and said, if a person wants to represent my constituency, he must have the capacity to understand the problems of the society, I mean the constituency, find a solution to it, take it to the parliament or the assembly and find a solution to it. For that, they said, it requires some educational qualification. The editor of the Constituent Assembly debate writes, practically everybody in the assembly were agreeing to that, almost everybody. A little later, one person stood up and said, President sir, recently we adopted democracy as the political system of this country. And you said meaning of the word democracy is government of the people, by the people, for the people. Today sir, that is 1946-47, population of this country was 40 crores. Out of 40 crores, he said 80% were total illiterates. Sir, are you reserving democracy for 20% of the literates? He asked a question. The entire assembly was stunned. Nobody could answer. Then one elder stood up and said, I'm sorry. I made a mistake. I did not look at this issue from the point of view with which the honorable member is looking at. He is right. I'm wrong. Democracy cannot be reserved for any class or a group of people. It's everybody's right, he said. Why I'm giving this example is, our three pillars of the Constitution are the creation of this Constitution. We have now seen how the successor body called the Parliament or the Assembly, how it functions. We read in the papers how many walkouts take place, how many issues are discussed. There's a body called, group called Election Magazine. They audited the performance of Parliament members, Lok Sabha members from 2004 to 2009. And of 544 members, the one who spoke for at least once in the Parliament, were only 174. Fabulously paid, paid more than any person in India. I'm not questioning that. But what is that they're doing? 2014, UPA government was in power, India was in opposition. UPA presents the GST bill. Every economist has said if it is implemented, the economy of the country will grow. The NDA refused it by saying you are taking away the powers of the state. We will never allow it to be done. And the bill has to be dropped. 2016, the NDA comes to power. UPA is in the opposition. NDA presents the very same GST bill. UPA said, no, we will not allow you because you said it should not be done. I have seen people functioning in the parliament and how they have failed the people. Why? Because according to me, it's loss of values, responsibilities. That is one pillar of the Constitution. The second pillar of the Constitution, the executive. When the executive were being considered, many members said, they are the future administrators. We'll make the law and they will administer it. Let us appoint an independent body which will choose the best of the people for these posts. So created the public service commissions and all. What happened to public service commissions? Recently, the CID Karnataka have filed a charge sheet against the immediate past chairman of the public service commission in Karnataka. For they mentioned how much money is taken for each post. This is the executive. He who pays money and gets into it, will have to recollect it. The third pillar of the Constitution, the judiciary, which I served for more than 45 years. What's happened? One case has to be decided, it takes 15 to 16 years. Then the first appellate court, the second appellate court, the high court, the supreme court. How much time it gets to finally conclude a dispute? Why people are not doing anything about it? Yeah, the problem was there when I was a judge also. But I'm raising this issue right now. Why don't you sit together and find a policy. Why do you have multiple appellate forums or divisional forums? Why don't we adopt the American system? There's only two forums, the trial court and the appellate court. And a man goes to the appellate court, he must be very careful that his case is strong, otherwise if it is dismissed, he is severely, monetarily punished and all. And there's another system, because the very same people go to the judiciary also. Two things which immediately comes to my mind is, take Jayalalitha's case. 14 years the case was fought in Chennai, then the case was transferred to Karnataka, she was convicted. He goes up in appeal to the High Court, appeal is admitted, bail is not granted, they go to the Supreme Court. On the mentioning stage, the judge grants bail. Now, no objection, I too would have granted the objection. But an unsolicited direction was given. This case shall be disposed of within 3 months by the High Court. Why? And that hundreds and hundreds of people who have been in jail for 10 years, 15 years, their cases are not taken up. You have granted bail. Where is the need for this case to be decided expeditiously? Why? Because rich and the powerful have a separate line of litigation. Similar is the case with Salman Khan. 3 o'clock the judgment, 4 o'clock the appeal is admitted by the High Court. Within 2 months the case is decided. This shows the very same people who live in this society which has no moral values go to the pillar of the legislature, the executive or the government. This doesn't mean this fall in moral values confined only to these three pillars of the Constitution. Take the media. Media is not a creation of the Constitution. It, because of its own good work and the people's love, people started calling it the fourth estate, equating it with the three pillars of the Constitution. What's happened to the media? A few years back, some of you might have heard the name Neera Radia. Paid news concept. You take money and print a false news, and readers will believe it. What's happened to our society? Let me give you one or two examples of my experience in the Lokayukta, how the system functions because of lack of moral value. In 2008, a handicapped tailor and his wife of a 6 months old child came to my institution. I asked him, what's the problem? The father said, sir, this child looks perfectly all right. It has no rectum. It eats through the mouth, defecates through the mouth. The local doctor said, don't worry about it. You take the child to a specialty hospital where a pediatric surgeon will rectify the mistake. They took the child to a government medical college hospital. The surgeon there examines the child and says, I'll do it. Everything will be all right. It'll cost you so much money though. Money is not expenses, money is bribe. Husband and wife gave all their money and kept it in the table of the doctor. He counts it and says, oh, for this money I'll make a hole near the rib cage so that the fecal matters can keep going out from there. Look at this pediatric surgeon. He must have prayed to God, give me education, make me a doctor, make me a pediatric surgeon. And he gets all that and comes and joins the government hospital, which in my opinion today meant for the poorest of the poor only. Everybody knows who goes there is a very poor person. It is said jocularly, patients who go vertically come out horizontally from these hospitals and all. But still, look at him. He could have given a future to that child. The greed in him did not allow him to do that. When it came to this is my office. We also could have got rid of the problem by giving a letter to the Victoria Hospital or Boring Hospital. But by that time, we learned a lot of things and all. Our officers took the child to Manipal Hospital in the old airport road and we begged the doctors to do the operation. They did it. The child today is perfectly all right. I was in a TV show about 2 months back and the studio people had invited the parents and the girl. The girl is about 9 years old and she's in the third standard. Look at her future. What would have happened to her because of the greed in that? This is one example. I can reel out hundreds and hundreds of examples like this and all. But I don't have the time. This is one example I give it for not having contentment in life and the consequences thereof. Let's take humanism. There is no species called human beings. We are not born to a species called human beings. We are born to a species called Homo sapiens. In my opinion, even though you are not born as a human being, in the journey of your life, you acquire humanism, exhibit it, and die as a human being. There is no better glory than that. That should be our ambition in life. Let me give you an example of lack of humanism. In 2011, an air marshal telephoned to me from Hyderabad. He said, Mr. Hegde, I didn't know him earlier. 3 days back, my 18-year-old, older brother's 18-year-old daughter is killed in a road accident in Bangalore. 3 days, the postmortem is not done. The body is not sent to Hyderabad. We have kept an ambulance outside the hospital. Please try and understand our sorrow. We have lost a young member of the family. There are members who have not even sipped water for 3 days. Her last rites are not done. I understand our sorrow. I said, I'll get back to you in a couple of hours. I went to the hospital, met the superintendent. He said, it's impossible. I have deputed 2 doctors for that purpose only. Let's call them. And he sent for them. One of them came to know Lokayukta was sitting in the office, so put leave and went away. The other man comes. Look at his dialogue. As he enters, he says, what's the hurry? Body is not decaying. It's in a freezer. Am I to examine the dead body first or treat a living patient first? The superintendent asked, who asked you to go to the main hospital to treat a patient? Because you have been deputed to a postmortem ward, which is a morgue, which is far away from the main building. He said, one person came and said, his relative is not getting a proper treatment, therefore he invited me to come and treat him. I asked him, doctor, did you know that the patient or his relative before? He said, no. Main building has 50 to 60 qualified doctors in various disciplines there. Here comes a stranger who doesn't even know him, walks 100 meters to the morgue and invites a doctor who is now in another duty altogether. Look at the bluff. I told him, okay, I understood it, doctor. I'll sit here until the postmortem is done and the body is put on the hearse there. He did it, the body was sent. Well, look at this. His duty is only to do postmortem. He might have done hundreds of postmortem for a dead body. It doesn't mean anything to him. But if it is his own daughter, this is the society in which we are. At the same time, I'm not saying everybody is bad. There are good people. An example of a person who has humanism is last about 3-4 months back in the outskirts of Bangalore, there was a motorcycle accident and a rider by name Harish Nanjappa, a 29-year-old person, he was killed. His body was divided into two because a punctured wheel of a lorry went over his body and 2 parts were separate, but he was still alive. There are dozens of people around him taking the video, taking pictures, he was asking for little water. Nobody gave it. The ambulance comes, the staff pick up the pieces of the body and put it, he was still alive. And he told the ambulance attendant, please tell the doctor to donate my eyes. Look at this tool, humanism. My dear youngsters, you alone can change it. You must have an ambition to grow, ambition to become somebody big, ambition even to become rich. Legitimately earned wealth is no product of sin. Earn it in crores if you can. But legitimately pay your tax and spend it legitimately. Don't put your hand into the pocket of another person, take his belongings. Don't put stone in his stomach and take his belongings. You are a human being if you have inculcated humanism in you. And you got to change. If you don't change, I don't want to see the number of zeros in the future scams that may come out. The only way to change is change yourself. Bring a better society. Change the society. Not for my sake, I'm in the last lap of my race, but for your own sake, to live in a better society. Otherwise, there will be conflict. One last thing. My dear students, this country is not governed by one religion. We have multiple religions. It's not governed by one language. It's a multiple language. It's not one culture. It's a multiple culture. This country can be very easily divided by taking out these and raising your demands on that basis. What will happen to the future of this country? Thank you very much for listening to me.